Okay. Do you see my screen, students?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do you see this whiteboard? One Microsoft OneNote.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, first thing is, why should you study numerical methods and statistical technique? So first, let us concentrate on the first term, numerical methods. Why should we study numerical methods? So numerical methods mean you will numerically solve the problem. So there are two types of methods. If you classify the methods to solve a particular problem of your choice, so either you will be solving the problem analytically. Analytically means some algebraic calculations will be there, and at the end you will obtain the solution of the given problem, and that will be the exact solution. No error will be there in that solution. What is error? That will be discussed later, but you have the basic understanding about error. So a problem is given and you will do some algebraic manipulations, and you at the end you will get a solution, and in that solution you have no error. So that is analytical method. And what is numerical methods? When you have no analytical methods, or analytical methods are very time consuming or expensive, then you need the help of numerical methods. So in numerical methods, you will write a code. Basically, you will first model the problem, then you will write a code, and the computer will do the task for you. And what will be the compensation? Numerical methods, most of the time you will not be able to get the exact solution, but you will get a nearby solution. So some error will be there in the numerical solution, so that will be the compensation you will be giving. You will get to know there are several real life situation in the course. When we will solving a particular problem, then you will get to know that there are several situation when analytical solutions are not possible. Then you have to consider numerical methods. Okay. So first thing in this unit you are going to study will be about errors. Why don't I describe that from this PDF sheet? Okay. Just a moment, let me open this with Microsoft Edge so that I'll be able to write on the PDF. Open with Microsoft Edge. Do you see the screen, students? This one. Students, are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So this is the syllabus of the course. Are you familiar with this? I have downloaded it from your website, from your department. Numerical methods and statistical technique, first one. Okay. So first one will be about errors. You see, error in numerical computations and their analysis. So what is error? The difference between true value and the approximated value. So you are solving some problem, it will have some exact solution, and by some numerical method you will get a nearby solution. So the difference between the exact solution and the nearby solution, that will be the error. That is one way to measure error. There are several other way to quantify error, relative error, percentage error, that will be discussed. And next part of the theory will be how to analyze error. So can you tell me briefly what is the equation of projectile motion? If you want to calculate how far the projectile has traveled in horizontal direction, what is the formula for that? S equals to ut plus
half
a t square. Okay, this is the formula. S is the distance traveled, u is the initial velocity, t is the time, a is the acceleration. So you see, initial velocity, you may commit some mistake to calculate the exact initial velocity. You may also commit some mistake to count the time, how much time has been covered, how much time has been passed. Or also you may commit some mistake to calculate the exact acceleration. So if you have some amount of error in the initial velocity in your calculation, okay, so when you are measuring the initial velocity, you may commit some mistake. So there will be some initial error in the initial velocity. There may be some error in counting how much time has passed, how much time has passed. Or similar way, you may have committed some mistake to exactly quantify the acceleration. So if you have small errors in all the right hand side quantities, how much effect will be there on the left hand side quantity, which is distance covered by the projectile, is not it? So the question is, in general, if you are given a function u, which is function of suppose x, y, z, I've taken only three variables. So if you know that in x we have committed delta x amount of error, in y we have committed delta y of amount of error, now how these will be quantified, how these will be calculated, that is different issue, we'll be going through in details. So suppose you have committed delta x amount of error in measuring x, delta y amount of error in measuring y, and delta z amount of error in measuring z. So how much effect will be there on the function u, which is depending on the variables x, y, z? Here on the left hand side, s is depending on u, t, and a. So if you have delta u amount of error in u, delta t amount of error in t, and delta a amount of error in a, how much error you will be committing on the left hand side term or left hand side expression s? So that will be discussed. Is it okay so far? I'm not going in details. I'm telling briefly what we are going to cover. Again, make you understand that. Next part of the theory will be how to find out root of algebraic and transcendental equations. Next part will be how to find out roots of algebraic and transcendental equations. These are the methods: bisection methods, iteration methods, Newton-Raphson methods, method of false position, and you will be learning some methods to find out complex root of a given equation. Now, what is root? What is root of an equation? Tell me, anybody? What is root of an equation? Suppose the equation is f of x equals to 0. So what is root of this equation? Alpha is a number, it may be real or complex. Alpha will be said to be a root of this equation f of x equals to 0 if
f of alpha equals to 0.
F of alpha equals to 0. So what does mean by that? That the curve f of x is going to cut x-axis. The curve, if you plot it in xy plane, this is x axis, this is y axis. So if you plot y equals to f of x curve in xy plane, this curve is going to cut x axis at x equals to
alpha.
So that is the root of an equation. Now if it is complex, you will not be able to geometrically represent that value, because in case of complex number, it will not be cutting x axis, but it will be satisfying the equation f of x equals to 0. So why should we study numerical methods? You already know how to solve a quadratic equation, is not it? What is the formula to solve quadratic equation? Ax square plus bx plus c equals to 0. How to solve it? What is the formula minus b plus minus root over b square minus 4ac by 2a. Is not it?
Yes, sir.
So these are the roots for a quadratic equation. So equation may not be quadratic. So what will happen if the equation is by cubic? In case of cubic equation, you have a exact method. If the equation is cubic, let's say ax cube plus bx square plus cx plus d equals to zero, then also you have an exact method to find out all the roots of the equation. How many roots a nth degree polynomial equation has? Exactly how many roots? If the degree of the polynomial equation is n.
N minus 1.
No, why? Why? This is a quadratic equation. How many equation it has? How many roots it has? This quadratic equation. Two. So if the equation, the degree of the equation is n, the equation has exactly n roots. If it is polynomial equation, I am not asking something, some other equation. For example, if I give you sin x equals to zero, it is not polynomial equation. So I am not talking about that kind of equation at the time being. For the time being, okay. This anyway, this sin x equals to zero. How many roots this equation has in real line?
Infinitely many.
So I am, for the timing, I am talking about polynomial equation. So if the degree of the polynomial equation is n, then the polynomial equation has exactly n roots. The roots may be complex or real. So if the polynomial equation is of third degree, you have analytical method, which is one of the method is Cardan's method. Cardan's method, if you search in Google by Cardan's method, it will say that this is the method to solve a cubic polynomial equation, and you will be able to find out all the roots of this equation. Now, then let us increase the degree one more. So if it is a biquadratic equation, polynomial equation of degree 4, polynomial equation of degree 4, ax4 plus bx cube plus cx square plus dx plus e equals to zero. So this is a biquadratic equation. Even for this biquadratic equation, you have an analytical method to find out all the four roots of this equation, which is known as Ferrari's method. Now the thing is, if the degree of the polynomial equation is more than 4, that means 5, 6 and so on, or it is not a polynomial equation, it is a polynomial equation if it is of this form. So if the degree of the polynomial equation is more than 4, or it is not a polynomial equation, it is a equation of the form sin x equals to 0, e power x plus sin x equals to 0, and so on, then you have no analytical method to solve the roots, to find the roots. So did you get my point? If the degree of the polynomial equation is more than 4, that means degree of the polynomial equation is starting from 5, or it is not a polynomial equation, some sine, cos, hyperbolic, these terms are included in the polynomial equation, then it is no longer polynomial. So if it is not a polynomial equation, or the degree of the polynomial equation is more than 4, then you have no analytical method which will give you the exact roots of the equations. Then what? You must have to consider some numerical methods to find the roots. Now you may say, sir, why roots are related to our branch? We are electrical engineering students. Why should we bother about roots of an equation? Okay, then wait for the moment. Whenever we'll be considering a particular topic, I'll give you a related example. Why should you study root finding methods? Is it okay? So some methods which we are going to study will be bisection methods. I'm not going in details. Then regular falsity method, then it will, there will be Newton Raphson method, iteration methods, and some methods will be there to find complex roots. For example, Lean-Weierstrass method and so on. Next part of the study in this course will be, let me see the syllabus. Interpolation. What is interpolation? Next part of our study will be interpolation. Do you know anybody the general meaning of interpolation? Students, are you with me or you have left the meeting?
Yes, sir.
You are there in the meeting?
Yes, sir.
So can you tell me what is general meaning of interpolation?
So do you know? Different polar coordinates.
Different polar coordinates. Okay, not like that. Okay. So let me describe this. So suppose you have some set of data points in two dimensions. So how to describe the data points in two dimensions? X naught, Y naught. This is one point in two dimension. You have another point X1, Y1. You have another point X2, Y2. And for the time being, let us restrict to four number of points. X4, Y4. These four you can consider in general as AN. So I have restricted our view to these four data points. X1, Y1, X2, Y2. Up to X4, Y4. These, not four, five data points are there. X0, Y0, X1, Y1, X2, Y2, X3, Y3. Here it will be X3, Y3. And X4, Y4. So these five data points are there. So let us plot these data points in two dimension. This is X axis, this side, and this side is Y axis. So let us plot. We do not know exact values of these coordinates, so let us arbitrarily plot it. So suppose this is X naught, Y naught. I have to. Okay. So suppose this is X naught, Y naught. This is X1, Y1. This is X2, Y2. This is X3, Y3. And let's say this is X4, Y4. And these data points are exact data point. No error is there. For example, you are counting the number of people in a certain village in each year. So in consecutive 5 years, so X values are years and Y values are the number of people in that village. So you can get exact values, yes or no? Suppose, yes, you are counting number of people in a village in 5 consecutive years. So you can get exact data, yes or no? How many people are there in a certain year in that village?
Yes.
Both X naught will be exact, no error is there, and Y naught is also exact. Similarly for the remaining years. So suppose the data points are exact data point, no amount of error is there in the data points. Then the question is, if I ask you, so let us for the timing make this data bit real. So suppose in year 2001, you have 10,000 people in a village. 10,000, it will not be a village. Let us make it 1,000. Okay. In the year 2004, I will be collecting the data in 3 year apart. So number of people, so let's say 1,200. In the year 2007, number of people are 1,270. And in the year 2010, number of people are, let's say, 1,310. And in the year 2013, number of people, sir, let's say 1400. So these are the five data points I have taken. Is it okay? 1. It is not moving. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now if I take an in between year from the starting year and end year, starting year is what? X naught is what? Year 2001. And what is X4? The last year. Now if I pick an arbitrary year which are not included in the data set, so tell me a year which is not included in the data set between 2001 and 2013. Okay, 2009. So let us take XP, which is arbitrary point between 2001 and 2013, which is you are suggesting as 2009. So the question is, how many people are there in that village in the year 2009? What is F of XP, number of people in the year 2009? You may make a guess, in the year 2007, number of people are 1270, and in the year 2010, number of people are 1310. So in the 2009, I'll be suggesting, I'll be guessing, okay, 1300 people are there. Will that be a reasonable guess? 1300 people are there in the year 2009. Will that be a reasonable guess?
No, sir.
Maybe.
Yes, in 2007, yes, we have 1270, and in the 2010, you have 1310. So in 2009, I may make a guess, okay, 1300 people are there. Will that be a reasonable guess? Guess, for guess it's okay, but you are not at all bothering about the all other data points, the first data point, the second data points, and the last data points. You are not at all bothering, you are ignoring them. You cannot ignore, you have to take into account all the data points, and you have to make a formula, consistent formula, not a guess, and that should be giving you the answer. So what you have to do, you have to find out a function, rather let's say polynomial. You will have to find out a polynomial which will be passing through all these five data points. So somebody may say, sir, this is the graph which I plotted. This is the graph which is representing the five data points. Some other student may say, no, sir, this is not the graph. This is the graph. This is the graph which is representing the five data points. Some other students may say, no, sir, I will be taking this curve. I will be taking this curve, which is representing the five data points. So if I do not mention anything, if I simply say, okay, draw a polynomial which will be passing through the data points. Here we have five data points, then there are infinitely many polynomials which will be passing through the data points. But if I restrict your answer, okay, you can use at max 4-degree polynomial for five data points. For n data points, n minus 1-degree polynomial. If I restrict this way, then all of you will be able to identify only one polynomial which will be passing through the all data points. If I ask you to use n minus 1-degree polynomial for n data points, here how many data points are there in our considered scenario?
Five.
So if I ask you, okay, find a polynomial of 4-degree, one less than the number of data points. So if I ask you, okay, find a polynomial of 4-degree which will be passing through these five data points, then all of you will end up with the same function, same polynomial of 4 degree. So then your question will be, sir, once you get the polynomial, you give any input, you will get the corresponding output. Yes or no? Once you know the rule, how the data points are, I should not say the rule, you do not know the exact rule, how the data points are created, but that will be one way to find a rule, how the data points are created. So once you have obtained the rule, then you can give any input, corresponding output will be there. Yes or no? Yes or no?
Yes.
Now you may say, sir, why not higher order polynomial? Okay, higher order polynomial has some limitation. At the beginning and starting of the higher order polynomial, you will see a rapid fluctuation. It will be going very up and then going very down for higher order polynomial. So at the beginning and at the end, you will get very absurd answer, even for this reasonable data set. If you try to approximate this data point by 100 degree polynomial or 1000 degree polynomial, you can do, but at the beginning of the data point, at the near 2001 and at the end 2013, you will get absurd answer, because higher order polynomial rises very rapidly at the beginning and at the end of the data points. You will get to know when you will be solving a problem, and we'll be going through the chapter interpolation. Okay, so some methods you will learn how to find out this polynomial. If the data points are n, your aim will be to find out a polynomial of degree n minus 1. And some methods you will learn, that will be Newton's forward difference formula, Newton's backward difference formula. Those will be for evenly spaced data point. If the x values are at a regular interval, here x values are at a 3-hour apart, is not it? So those will be evenly spaced data points if the x values are uniformly distributed. If the x values are at a regular interval. So here in the current scenario, x values are what? 2001, 2004, 2007, 2010, 2013. So each x values are 3 years apart from each other. So these are called evenly spaced data points. So for evenly spaced data points, you will learn some methods how to find out the polynomial. And for unevenly spaced method, unevenly spaced points or data points, you will learn few other methods, which will be Newton's divided difference formula, Lagrange interpolation formula, and few other methods are there. That was about interpolation. Next one will be curve fitting. Curve fitting. Most probably, let me see. You see, unit 3, curve fitting. What is curve fitting? Curve fitting. So same like interpolation, but here a little modification is required. So the data points will have some errors. Data points will have some amount of errors. Okay. So for example, you are trying to find, so you have given a metal rod. Okay. You have given a metal rod and you want to find out the resistance. Exact formula for resistance with respect to time, how the resistance is changing with respect to time. So what you will do, you will heat up the rod, and at different time, let's say T1, T0, T1, T2, T3, T4. These 5 instances, you will be recording the resistance. Okay. So time part will have no error. The time part, the x values, your x values are time. So x values will have no error. You are able to perfectly count the time. So no error in input values. No error in input values. Okay. But in output values, you will have some amount of error. So while you are calculating the resistance at the time T0, suppose your resistance is R1 and you have not getting the exact value, some plus minus is there in R1. Similarly, at the time T1, suppose this is R0. At the time T1, suppose the resistance is R1 and some plus minus is there. This is not the exact value. Similarly, at T2, resistance is R2, at T3, resistance is R3, and T4, resistance is R4. Okay? Now it will be up to you what kind of relation you want to get between temperature and resistance. If you wish to get a linear relation, then what will be the most consistent linear relationship with respect to the given data points? Now, if you want a quadratic relation between temperature and resistance, then what will be the most consistent or most suitable relationship between this temperature and the resistance? If you want exponential curve, you will ask yourself what kind of relation you want to get. So if you want to get exponential curve, what kind of exponential curve will be representing these temperature versus resistance data points in a most suitable manner? If you want a logarithmic curve to represent the data points, what will be the most suitable logarithmic curve which will be representing these data points? So some set of data points will be there. In input values, no error will be there, but in output values, some amount of error will always be there. Okay. Then you will be asking yourself what kind of relation you want to get from the given data points. If you want a linear, then what is the linear relationship which will be representing the data in most suitable manner? If you want a exponential or you want a quadratic, then what are the most suitable relations of that kind which will be representing the given data set? So for that, you will consider this curve fitting unit. Is it clear so far what I'm telling?
Yes, sir.
It is up to you what kind of relation you want to get. In general, if I consider this physical scenario, what kind of relation you are getting for a metal rod? Suppose the metal rod is of iron, aluminium, let's say aluminium metal rod. So how the resistance with respect to temperature will be changing, in a linear manner or non-linear manner? Any idea you have? If you heat up a metal rod of aluminium and you record its resistance at different temperature, then what kind of relation you are going to get?
Linear, sir.
You expect a linear. Huh? It may not be. I do not know the exact physical scenario, but it may be linear. If not, then we look at the data. Suppose while you are plotting, let me make it more clear by drawing in two dimension. So this side is temperature, and this side is resistance. And suppose this is the five data points are there. So this is suppose R0, T0. This is R1, T1. This is R2, T2. This is R3, T3. And this is R4, T4. So these are the five data points. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I have already told you in X values, which is basically your T0 values. It should have been in other way. T0, R0, T1, R1, and so on. It should have been in other way. T0 should have been coming earlier, T values. Let me remove this. Small eraser. Just a moment. I'll finish the lecture. I'll not take much time. Okay. So this is first. What happened? Hmm. I cannot write. It is not working properly. Just a moment. So these are the five data points you have, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, suppose. So this is your first data point, second, third, fourth, and fifth. So by looking at this, you can say, okay, there is a linear relationship. There is a linear relationship. So this is the straight line. You may say that this is the representing the five data points in a most suitable manner. But the answer is not that much simple. Some other student may say, no, not that line, sir. This is the line that is representing the data in a most suitable manner. So some sort of calculation you have to do to figure out which straight line will be representing the data in a most suitable manner. So that will be straight line fitting. Now, if you look at the data, somebody may say, sir, no, I think there is a quadratic linear relationship, quadratic relationships are there between the data points. And this is the quadratic function which is representing the data. Will that be absurd or will that be reasonable to think that there is a quadratic relationship is there? In the current scenario, if the data points are given by these dots, and if somebody says that sir, there is a quadratic relationships are there in the data, will that be reasonable or absurd? So you will be posing the question yourself by looking at the data, what kind of relationship you want to get. And then you will do some calculation to figure out exact curve, not exact curve, the most suitable curve of that kind. So that will be curve fitting. Next will be numerical integration, next unit. So numerical integration and differentiation. So there are certain integration. Let me ask you this question. What is the physical meaning of this integration? Integration a to b f of x dx. What is the physical meaning?
The area under area. The
curve. Area under the curve. So this is x equals to a, this is x equals to b, and suppose this is the curve y equals to f of x. Then this area that is represented by the integration a to b f of x dx, is not it?
Yes.
Now certain integrations are not that much easy. So if I tell you this integration, let's say 0, not 1 to 2 dx by 1 plus x, is this a easy integration or difficult? Easy?
Yes,
1 plus x, then you will evaluate the value between 1 and 2. But if I briefly change it, if I make this integration 1 to 2 dx by x plus sin x, is it now easy or difficult? Dx by x plus sin x?
Difficult, sir.
Difficult. So if I ask you, okay, tell me a value, reasonable value for this integration. How to do that? So you know definite integral is by, that is geometrically represented by area under the curve. So if somehow you can approximate the area under the curve x plus sin x from x equals to 1 to x equals to 2, you will have your answer, yes or no?
Yes, sir.
So that is what we are going to learn in numerical integration, how to approximate the area under the curve for a definite integral. And some method you are going to study, that will be Simpson's one third rule, trapezoidal rule, Simpson's 3/8 rule, Weddell's method, Gould's method, and so many other methods are there to approximate the area under the curve. So main logic will be how to approximate the area under the curve. Okay, that will be numerical integration, and numerical differentiation also will be discussing at that time. And then, since you are electrical engineer, if you consider a electrical circuit, you will be applying Kirchhoff's circuit law, voltage law, and you will get a system of linear equations to find out the exact voltage in each of the nodes. So we'll consider a particular example in your branch, and then we'll see the application. So you will have to learn some method how to solve system of linear equation. So in unit 5, we are going to do that. We are going to learn some method, numerical methods to solve system of linear equations. That will be Gauss-Seidel method, Gauss-Jacobi method. Then also you are going to study LU decomposition method, L star decomposition method, and so on. And last part will be a brief about statistical computations. So I'll not be discussing today what we are going to learn in statistical computation because time is already up. Now, what are the books we are going to follow? I'll be following these two books. One will be by S.S. Sastry. Let me tell you the books. I've already uploaded. PDFs of these books are uploaded in the MS team. Let me go back to that team. Okay, do you see this page?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Click on the general tab. General tab. I've clicked it. Okay. On the left hand side, general tab is there. Click on that. Okay. Come to the top of the page. Do you see file here? General, post, files.
Yes, sir.
Cursor. Look at the cursor. Do you see files?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Click on that. I have clicked it. You see class materials. Again, click on that. You see, I have already uploaded some books. Okay. So these are the books I am going to follow. And anything class related things, it may be class notes, it may be assignments, it may be any other documents, supplementary documents. I'll be uploading all those documents in this class material folder. Whenever I mention that it is uploaded in class material folder, you click on this general tab, then on the top file, then class material, then you will be able to find out the materials. I'll make proper folder by suitable name. You will be able to download it from here. You will not be able to edit it. You will not be able to upload your own file in this folder. It will be restricted to me only. So you can download it. Any file attached in this folder, you'll be able to download it. Now, time to time, I'll be giving you assignments. So for that, link will be created and you will be shared the assignment sheet. You have to write down the solutions in a A4 paper. And then you will have to create a single PDF file to upload that in the attached link. And time to time, your assignment will be evaluated and it will be returned back to you with comments. So that part, and also time to time quiz will be conducted. I do not know still when you will be called. So I have to prepare myself for that. So starting from the beginning, in a regular interval, quiz will be conducted. Whenever a particular unit is completed, from that unit, quiz will be conducted.
Excuse me, sir.
So today I'll be ending the discussion. Now let us, you may ask something.
Can you please also upload the timetable of third sem?
Actually, I do not have your timetable. I have only my timetable.
Okay, sir.
Thank you. You ask it in your department, it will be prepared by your department.
Yes, sir.
So you ask your head, and obviously, since classes are starting, you should have your timetable, na? So you ask your head, okay?
But we don't know who are head.
Okay, then you ask your teacher, any teacher you can ask. UG supervisor will be there, no? UG advisor, undergraduate advisor, you must have known him. You call him and ask for the timetable. It should be provided to you. It should not be like you should be asking. Anyway, so anything else you want to ask? This is the very first class. So if you say something, I will be tried to follow. Anything you want to say?